Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so today we're very pleased to have Niels Brown visiting us from Simon Fraser University, and he'll speak on Genius 2 curves with 4-4 split Jacobians, and which is joint with his student, Kevin Dirksen, and which won the best poster prize at ANTS last year. Thanks, Niels.
Thank you, Kristen. So yeah, first of all, I of course like to thank Kristen and Renier Brugger for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to talk about this subject. It's a let's just first start to look at the setting a little bit, and then we can discuss what we'll actually be doing in the talk. Okay, so we'll be looking at, well, K will be a field of characteristic different from 2. C, as in fact, later on we'll just, different from 2 will be enough, actually. We'll consider a curve C of genus 2 over K, and it's Jacobian, and we say that a Jacobian J is split over K, or in general, an abelian variety is split if it's isogenous to a product of elliptic curves. So if it admits a finite morphism that preserves the group structure to a product of elliptic curves. So for abelian surfaces, there's actually a nice result if you work through it. There's only very limited ways in which you can get split abelian surfaces, and this is the construction. If you actually have a Jacobian of a genus 2 curve that is split, then in fact the curve C will have to admit morphisms to those elliptic curves themselves, each of degree n. Well, a priori those maps are not well defined because you can change these factors themselves by isogenies again, but you can actually pick them out in such a way that the morphisms are of degree n each. the isogeny from E1 to E2 times E2 to the Jacobian can be expressed really quite easily in terms of pullbacks along your morphism. And in fact, your Jacobian is of a very specific form. You will have an isomorphism from the n-torsion on the one curve to the n-torsion on the other curve. You will get that allows you to embed basically the n-torsion diagonally into the product, and that group will actually be exactly the kernel of this isogeny over here. So if J is a Jacobian, then obviously it's principally polarized, and then you see that your delta n has to be maximally isotropic with respect to the Weyl pairing, and that really means that this lambda n here it's an isomorphism of group schemes, but in fact it would have to be an anti-isometry with respect to the Weyl pairing. So it should flip the sign on the way on the Weyl pairing. So you can make these things using 2 elliptic curves with anti-isometric n-torsion. Okay, so the goal we set ourselves today is to try and find universal genus 2 curves with a split NN Jacobian, so sort of a model from which you can obtain any genus 2 curve with an NN split Jacobian, it will not be a universal model in the strict sense of the word, because the moduli space that we're looking at is not fine here. But just as for Weierstrass models, Weierstrass model itself is not really a universal model for an elliptic curve, but nonetheless, you can get any elliptic curve from specializing the parameters in a Weierstrass model. So in that sense, we will try and create something that really looks a little bit like a universal model. Okay, so the approach for N, 2, 3, and 5 is to really use those maps phi 1 and phi 2 that you get from the genus 2 curve to the elliptic factors of the Jacobian. And Francani have a very nice result where they show that those morphisms actually factor through the hyper. They can be made so that they so that you can get a cover from a P1 to a P1 that behaves nicely with respect to the hyperelliptic involution. So if you work it out, it turns out you can find a diagram like this, and now you can try and describe your curves C by trying to see, okay, well, if you have an elliptic cover of a P1 here, and you have a cover of P1s over here of degree n, it would have to have the same degree as that map, such that the fiber product of these two curves is actually of genus 2. That's actually hard. If you take a fiber product like this in general, if this n is big, then the genus of this curve would be very high. So you have to have a lot of canceling ramification between these morphisms, and that is what allows you to get a lot of conditions on what these pi 1s can look like in terms of the morphism that you have over there. And that gives you so many equations that you can actually just solve it and get equations for what these things can look like. And then you just take the fiber product to get your genus 2 curve. For n is 4, in fact, it turns out there is some partial work already going back till 1887. This was pointed out to me by Everett Howe, who would know the history of these things very well. So he actually sent me an email. He saw the preprint and he said, oh, you should look at this paper. I have to say I haven't done so in detail yet, but it really looks like he says, okay, well, if you have this hyperelliptic integral with certain symmetries to it, then you can do this degree 4 transformation and express it in elliptic integrals, which ultimately boils down to something like this. And his in his setting, the degree 4 really corresponds to the 4x4 splitness. Okay, so for a historical point of view, this is very interesting. Of course, as much of this work, it's over C. And we would be interested in doing this over algebraically non-closed fields. And as we'll see, actually, that is where a couple of the interesting things happen. Okay, so our approach for 4-4 split Jacobians will be the following. As you saw, what you need to create an n-n split Jacobian is to take two elliptic curves with isomorphic n-torsion, really anti-isometric if you take the Weyl pairing into account. And if the 4 torsion of E1 and E2 is isomorphic, then that's certainly the case for the 2 torsion as well. So your 4-4 isogeny will actually factor through a 2-2 isogeny. So if we understand 2-2 split Jacobians, that should get us a long way towards understanding the 4-4 split ones as well. So we will really try and use this diagram over here. So the steps that we will be using here is first, we want to give a description of the 2-2 split Jacobians. That's completely classical. It's easy. But in addition, we want that this J2, which will have a 2-2 isogeny to this product here, admits a second 2-2 isogeny to this J4 here. And if you work it out, they have to have trivially intersecting kernels. And that's turns out to be an important bit of information because there's other configurations where that doesn't happen. And those would not correspond to 4-4 split Jacobians. So in order to check that the kernels trivially intersect, you can just look at what the isogeny back here is. That's the push forward along these phi 1 and phi 2 of your divisors. The kernel of that will really just be the image of the 2 torsion over there, because the composition of the 2 really is multiplication by 2. And that really does intersect. That's completely misspelled on the slide. This should be delta 4 modulo delta 2, which would be the kernel of this thing over here. Sorry, so this is wrong in the slide, of course. These two things do not intersect trivially at all. They're identical. So once we figured out what the condition is for that, then the next bit is to actually identify J4. So that means that we actually have to take the image under a 2-2 isogeny. 2-2 isogenies are also called Richelieu isogenies for genus 2 Jacobians. They're well understood, at least geometrically. And it turns out that in our case, actually, to do this over an algebraically non-algebraically closed field, we have to do a little bit of extra work here. Because people have only considered Richelieu isogenies with very specific Galois structures on the kernel. There's still a little bit to do there. And that was, perhaps that was one of the things I found most satisfying out of this project, that finally I saw how that worked out. It turns out to have a very easy answer. In a way, this project is really just a little bit of housekeeping in the arithmetic of genus 2 curves. It's just plugging together some results and completing things here and there where they are not quite complete yet. Okay, so the 2-2 split Jacobians, I'll describe them here in a very straightforward way. They always turn out to fit in a diagram like this. So a 2-2 split Jacobian is always, the genus 2 curve will have to be a double cover of 2 distinct elliptic curves. So it has to be a bi-elliptic genus 2 curve, which really means that you have to have an extra involution. Well, you have to have a bunch of extra involutions on your C2, in fact, because this thing is Galois here. So there's an involution over C2 over E1. Which means that you get an extra involution over here, which factors down to the quotient by the hyperelliptic involution, which gives you a further P1 down here. So you see that these bi-elliptic genus 2 curves have to be V4 covers of a projective line, and 2 of the factors that you get in there will be elliptic curves, and that's exactly what you're looking at. So if you do that, just in general, if you prescribe yourself one of those elliptic curves, we can, without loss of generality, at least if we assume that our characteristic is not 2 or 3, we can write this elliptic curve in this form over here, just a short Weierstrass form. The other elliptic curve here, if you work it out, has to be ramified at 3 of the points where your E1 is ramified as well, in order for this thing to be of genus 2. So that means that this E2 will probably not be ramified over, say, infinity, but it has to be ramified over another point A here, and then you can still allow yourself a twist. And from that, you can just compute the fiber product of these things to get your equation for C2. So it's really just taking the cubic polynomial here and substitute something quadratic inside. Okay, so that gives us a good description of all. So this is an example of what I'll consider to be a universal model for a genus 2 curve with a 2-2 split Jacobian. Here you have a bunch of parameters, your B and C, and you get additionally an A and a D that you can specialize to values to actually get genus 2 curves with a 2-2 split Jacobian. And any such curve can actually be obtained from specializing these particular models. But as you see, there are many distinct values that you can plug in here that give you isomorphic curves. So it's not really a universal family. Okay. So the next step is to understand our two isogenies a little bit better, Richelieu isogenies. So just a quick recap. I think most of the people in this audience already know this. So I can skip over this pretty quickly. If you write your elliptic curve as y squared equals a sextic, then you can just write down your two torsion in the Jacobian as differences of the ramification points of your C over the canonical model. So these are the branch points of C over the x-line. And clearly those points, well, if you take a divisor of this form and multiply it by 2, then you get the divisor of a rational function. So these are clearly two torsion points. And now you just have to work out that this gives you all. And in addition, we can actually see the Weyl pairing from this representation really quite easily too. If you take two of those two torsion points, you simply look at how big the overlap is between their support. And if they overlap at, well, if they overlap at two points, then you're looking at the same point, so that should pair trivially. If they're overlapping at exactly one point, then you're using 3 points in your support in total, so then it's odd. Those points pair non-trivially. And if they have disjoint support, then they pair trivially again. That turns out to be exactly the Weyl pairing on your genus 2 Jacobian. Yeah?
Aren't there more two torsion points than just the ones like P minus... Oh, sorry, that's not infinity. So it's any I and J.
Yeah, it's two choose. Yeah, so it's 6 choose 2. So that's exactly 15 plus 16. That's so the trivial. Yeah, okay. So okay. It's not right. So if you take I equal to J, then you get the origin, and that's the only point that has multiple representations in this form. Because this is genus 2, this is really all. If you go to higher genus hyperelliptic curves, yes, then you have to consider larger linear combinations of the various truss points as well. Okay, so this gives us a good understanding of the two torsion. That's good, because now we can start looking at Richelieu isogenies. So if you have an isogeny between Jacobians, or between a Jacobian and a product of elliptic curves, so if you have an isogeny between abelian varieties that over an algebraically closed field would be principally polarized, then you get this result that in order for these things to actually be compatible with the Weyl pairing, the kernel of your isogeny has to be maximally isotropic. That is to say, the kernel has to be such that the Weyl pairing restricts to a trivial pairing on that kernel, and the kernel will actually be of maximal size to still allow that property. And for n is 2, this means that, well, your kernel is going to be of order 4. And it has to consist of points that pair pairwise trivially, and that means that the distinct points just have to be disjoint support. So in order to be able to write down a subgroup of the Jacobian like this, essentially what you have to do is pair up the roots in three groups of 2. So what it corresponds to is to write down a quadratic splitting of your polynomial, your sextic polynomial f, in the following way. Well, there's the leading coefficient to take care of. So it would be good if the leading coefficient is a cube, because then you can just equally distribute the leading coefficient over the three quadratic factors, but changing your polynomial f, because the equation of your curve C is actually just y squared equals f of x. So changing the leading coefficient by a square doesn't hurt you at all. So you can easily assume that the leading coefficient is indeed a cube by just multiplying by the leading coefficient squared. And now you can just nicely distribute that over the three quadratic factors that you want to use in your f. Okay, so your isogeny is going to be defined over the base field. Well, a necessary condition for that is that at least the kernel has to be Galois stable. So you should make sure that your quadratic splitting that you're writing down here is Galois stable. And that turns out to be enough. Okay, so recapping, we are considering a genus 2 curve, y squared equals f of x. And its Jacobian will admit a Richelieu isogeny over the base field if and only if we can group the roots in three groups of two in a Galois stable way. So what can the Galois group, the Galois action on the roots, of course, factors through S6, you have a degree 6 polynomial, so there's some permutation action on the roots. So what can the Galois group still do? Well, you can swap any of these. So that gives you a C2 for each of the factors. And you can swap, you can permute each of the tuples in an arbitrary way. So that's just S3 acting semi-directly or on the C2 cube. So you get a wreath product of C2 and S3. It's the normal thing that you get when you consider these things. So this is a nice subgroup of S6, and that turns out to be the one point stabilizer in this set of quadratic splittings under S6. So once you've restricted your action to this group, to this one point stabilizer, then the quadratic splittings still have two orbits. You'll have the orbit containing quadratic splittings that share a pair with these, and you'll have an orbit of quadratic splittings that do not share a pair with these. So you get two orbits, and that means that if you want to look at two-point stabilizers, you get two conjugacy classes of those. You get a, if you work it out, you get a C2 times V4. So that's just by stabilizing one pair and allowing the different ways of grouping these things in other pairs. And there's a copy of S3 in there, which I'll denote as S3 twiddle. It's a group that acts transitively on the six roots. It's actually the image of the normal S3 inside of S6 under the outer automorphism of S6. Okay, so those are two subgroups that we can consider. And really, in order to have multiple Richelieu isogenies, you should have that Galois acts via one of those subgroups on your roots. So if your genus 2 curve admits multiple Richelieu isogenies, this polynomial f is actually going to have a not too big splitting field. This is a group of order 8, and this is a group of order 6. That's a much smaller splitting field than you'd normally expect for a sextic. Okay, so you can write down a little Galois theory diagram for this. On the bottom, you have your S6. So there, you're putting no level structure on your genus 2 curve at all. If you want to put full two-level structure on your Jacobian, then you would have to, basically allow for no action at all on your roots. You have to be able to distinguish all the two torsion points individually. You're not allowed to permute them at all anymore. So in terms of moduli spaces, this level would correspond to the moduli space of genus 2 Jacobians, genus 2 curves. And all the way up there, we would have our moduli space of genus 2 curves with full two-level structure. And in between, we have this level where we are fixing one Riescheau isogeny. So that's the analog of x naught 2 for elliptic curves. You're fixing one 2 isogeny on your elliptic curve. Here, a Riescheau isogeny on your genus 2 Jacobian. And in between here, we're finding two distinct ways of putting a little bit finer, but not full, two-level structure on our genus 2 Jacobian, corresponding to prescribing different Riescheau isogenies. And you can tell them apart by what their kernels look like, because that's how we found our orbits originally here. So if you go and look, you find that, okay, it's our curve here, the original one. This group is, that's the stabilizer of just, well, I mean, any conjugate of this would be a stabilizer of something conjugate to that. But if we just fix notation, it would say fix this quadratic splitting. C2 times V4 also stabilizes a splitting like this, 1, 2, 3, 5, 4, 6. So now you have swapped two things here. So these would correspond to, so if you find this as a Galois group for your polynomial f, you would find that there's two Riescheau isogenies, at least, in fact, there are three, because there's a third permutation here, which would also be stable under this group. But they would all share this factor here. So those kernels wouldn't be disjoint, or they wouldn't intersect trivially. And for your S3 twiddle here, there you find that there's also another quadratic splitting that gets stabilized of this form. And here you indeed see there's no sharing of pairs here. The kernels of the two isogenies here would in fact intersect trivially. So for our purpose, really what we're interested in is this S3 twiddle. So now we know that our curve C2 has to be 2-2 splits to start with. Well, we already determined what the model for that was. We could write those things as a fiber product of a Weier's truss form and a double cover of the projective line ramified at infinity and some other point A. And solving that, you can write down the model for your curve C2 in this form. And now if its Jacobian admits two Riescheau isogenies with trivially intersecting kernels, then this fx should really split over an S3 twiddle extension. So you know what the Galois action is on this polynomial f that we have here. Well, we really obtained our polynomial here from a cubic polynomial to start with. Which, so if this big polynomial f here splits completely, then this small polynomial f is going to split as well. And its Galois group would normally be S3. So it's, if you work it out, it's actually the same splitting field. So really what you need is that your big f here has the same splitting field as your cubic polynomial small f. So that's a very straightforward condition. So now you get your resolvents out, and you just write out what it means for your Galois groups to be like that. And you can actually find that you should choose your A's and D's of a specific form. Well, your D's are only defined up to squares, of course, because it doesn't matter if you change D by a square, it's just doing a twist. And it turns out you find these relations here, if we put A and D in these forms here, depending on a parameter S, then we will actually have the right kind of splitting of our polynomial f of x. And it's completely non-coincidental that the polynomial A that you get here, if you look at this, if if you look at how you multiply points by two on Weierstrass models, this is the x-coordinate. So if you take a point s comma something and multiply it by two on the elliptic curve with that short Weierstrass model, then you get that. Well, that's completely completely expected. And as you see here, the d has some very recognizable components in it as well. There's, you get the discriminant of your cubic in there again. Okay, so that means that we're basically there. We now have a model of our C2, because we should have this extra Richelieu isogeny, which we can ensure by having our A's and D's of this form, and by writing our C2 like that in the first place, we've already made sure that we have a 2-2 split Jacobian. So now we know that our J4 will actually be the image of the other Richelieu isogeny on this thing. Okay, so that's what we have here now. So given, yes.
J4 and J2 was?
Yeah.
Delta
2
and delta.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I can go quickly back to this diagram. That was there. Here. Okay, so we have our elliptic curve E1, that's sort of the data that we start with. We now want to create the genus 2 curves that are 4-4 isogenous to E1 times, well, whatever comes next to that. And it turns out that the things that come next to that are the E2s of this form. You just fill in your A's and D's that you got from your 2-2 splitness. And now by taking your A and D in a special way, you're making sure that you can actually go this extra step further to actually get something that's 4-4 split. So we already see now as well that this E2 here has to have isomorphic 4 torsion to our given curve E1. So we're actually recovering from this work that Rubin and Silverberg already did, where they actually wrote down explicit models of elliptic curves with prescribed 2, 3, 4, or 5 torsion. So in this case, we're recovering the result for prescribed 4 torsion, but we are actually getting anti-isometric 4 torsion here. So we twisted by something. It turns out, yeah, okay, that's actually some extra result. In order to flip the Weil pairing on the 4 torsion of an elliptic curve, it turns out that you have to twist by the discriminant of your elliptic curve. That's unique to 4. In general, you can't really just flip the Weil pairing and stay geometrically identical. You get different models. But okay. Okay, so really, we're just looking at our C2 here, and we now have to find the image of the second Richelieu isogeny that we have on the Jacobian of that curve. So for that, we need a little bit of extra work on Richelieu isogenies, because it turns out people always took the easy case there. Well, geometrically, they've only looked at the geometric case. That's essentially what I should say. So if you have your elliptic curve C2 with your genus 2 curve with a given quadratic splitting, we can write down a couple of quantities. We take this determinant D here that you get by taking the 3 by 3 matrix that you get by putting the coefficients of your quadratic factors in the matrix. So that gives you this delta. And you define 3 other quadratic factors now by taking appropriate determinants of your Fs and derivatives thereof. If you do the computation over here, a priori, you think, well, these are degree 1 polynomials, these are degree 2 polynomials. So if you take this determinant, you're going to get something of degree 3, but the leading term actually cancels, so you get something of degree 2. That's a very nice thing that happens. I mean, just look at the leading coefficients here. You're only putting in two things. Okay, and we're creating these other factors by just permuting our ijk cyclically. So that gives us three things. And now we can write down another genus 2 curve by just using these quadratic factors instead. And we are allowing ourselves a twist in front here because, well, who knows? So it's completely classical, and that's really where Bolza already started in his work too. It's completely classical that this is how you write down the genus 2 curve of which the Jacobian is Richelieu isogenous to what you started with. In the geometric case. So if your F1, F2, and F3 were defined over the base field to start with, then we don't need this delta here. We can just take a 1 here. And then, so then the Jacobians of these things are indeed 2, 2 isogenous. So if we disregard the problems that we get from our base field, then we've written down the right thing here. Well, what can the base field introduce? Is still a twist. So in general, a genus 2 curve only admits quadratic twists. So that's what we're getting here. So we have to figure out what delta is. That's because that's not given. The nice thing about this whole construction here, and you see that from the fact that you just permute these things cyclically, is that whatever Galois does on the FIs, it'll do exactly the same thing on the GIs. So the curve I'm writing down here, even if the FIs are not individually defined over K, but only Galois stable as a set over K, the equation I'm writing down here is still defined over the ground field. So that's the observation that's important here. We have a descent of the curve. We just have to figure out which descent, which twist to put in front.
Delta, you mean this to be an integer? You're talking about like the symmetric?
Yeah.
So some. Oh, no. This is just, I was already using a subscript. So no, this notation is just an ornament. It's putting delta somewhere on RC. For elliptic curves, it gets used as a twist. It's not it's not a symmetric product.
And so this delta in general, you're saying it's
an element of the field.
It's an element of your field K. Its value is only important up to squares.
Okay.
Sorry about you're right. If especially in a talk where you use genus 2 curves and Jacobians, people might think it's the symmetric product. No. This is just a curve. I did. Perhaps I should have written C4 comma delta. That might have removed the confusion, but at the expense of putting two subscripts. Okay. Okay, so which twist in general? Okay, there's actually a nice result, and that is basically how you prove Richelieu, that Richelieu isogenies in general actually work. Isogenies are given by correspondences between curves. So you don't actually get a map from one curve to the other curve, but you get a correspondence from one curve to the other. So that's to say, if you take the Cartesian product of one curve with the other one, normally a function would give you a graph in this product. Here, a correspondence, well, you can talk about its graph, but it won't give this nice one to some or many to one thing that you get for a map. It's a 2-2-2 correspondence in this case, in fact. And in this case, in fact, you can be completely explicit with the curve that you write down. So if we have our C and C twiddle here, obtained from the Richelieu isogeny on the previous page, then you can consider the curve gamma delta in this product given by the following equations over here. So this is giving us some biquadratic relation on the x's. And these relations give us a way of obtaining the y coordinates from that. There, I mean, this is biquadratic in x, so that gives us the 2 by 2 correspondence bit. And then given the x's, this is bilinear in the y. So if you prescribe one y, you get the others. Okay, so if we take our delta to be 1 here again, then this is just the classical Richelieu correspondence. This is exactly the thing that proves, if you work it out, that proves that you get this Richelieu isogeny. So the properties of this gamma inside this product here, its class in the Picard group of this surface, actually prescribes what kind of, if it defines an isogeny or not. Okay, but in our case, we can just use that geometrically that all works out. We only have to figure out what twist to put in. So in this case, as you see, so if gal acts trivially on our G1, G2, and G3, then nothing happens here. And if we then just take our delta to be 1, then this all works out as well. So if our F1 and F2 are in fact Galois conjugate with respect to the quadratic extension that you get by adjoining the square root of delta. In other words, if you have F1 and F2 quadratically conjugate, and you just take delta to be the discriminant of that quadratic extension, then if you go and figure out what happens here, if F1 and F2 can be exchanged by Galois, then it'll do exactly the same thing on the G's. So this equation remains unchanged. That's already Galois stable. And these two equations, if you go and look at it, Galois would interchange these two, and it would interchange the signs on these. So that means that as an ideal, this thing would, in fact, again, be Galois stable. So that's the right choice to take. So this solves the case when your F3 is over the base field and your F1 and F2 are quadratically conjugate. Well, that's really the only case you have to consider, because we are looking at quadratic twists. Making a cubic extension is not going to make anything a square that wasn't a square before. So you just go to the if F3 isn't over the base field already, just go to the cubic extension over which it does become over the base field. Then you use this result, you get the right value of your delta. And since the only thing that's important for your delta is its value up to squares, that doesn't get in, the cubic extension doesn't interfere with that. So then you're just done. And ultimately, this really just means that you should take delta to be the discriminant of your big polynomial f. So the delta is not trivial. Even though you were writing down the model here already, for delta equal 1, you can just write down this curve. That's actually not the right choice for your Richelieu isogeny. This should be the discriminant of your big polynomial f. So I thought that was very happy when I found that. And of course, in the end, in hindsight, if you look at it, yeah, of course, that's the only thing it really can be. But OK. So that gives us all the ingredients. Because now we can just write down our curve, f of x, here, with those parameters. And now we just have to write down the Richelieu isogenies for this thing. The fact that its Galois group is so restricted already gave us that there are other Richelieu isogenies available. So what we now can just do is write down this polynomial here. We only have we have three parameters now. We have our b, c, and we have our s. Because the a's and d's, that's just functions in s and b and c. So there's three unknowns. And now going to the splitting field of f is putting a degree 6 extension on top of that. That's something that you can actually still compute in. Even with these three unknowns in there, that's something that you can just about do. And you know that f actually splits over that extension, so you can just write down its 6 roots over that formal splitting field of the entire thing. And now you can just multiply those roots together in the all the possible ways to get the quadratic splittings. There's only 15 possibilities. And there's going to be a couple of them that turn out to be already defined over the base field that are actually Galois stable. So you just do that explicitly, and you find which Riescheloff isogenies turn out to be defined over the base field already. The descent happens for free, basically. And that means that you can just get your model of C4 because we know how to choose our delta in the Riescheloff isogeny as well. So you can do that and get your model. So, well, it fits on one page if you reduce your if you reduce your type a little bit. So the I'm sorry about the delta here is actually the discriminant of E1. So it's minus 4 times b cubed minus 27 times c squared. Okay, so it's a model. So you know that any 4-4 split Jacobian can be obtained by specializing your b's, c's, and s. S is in this equation, and in fact you know what all the other data is in terms of those parameters as well. You just fill in the formulas that we got in our other slides. So if you have a Jacobian that you suspect of being 4-4 split, I would certainly not suggest trying to see if you can write it and if you can solve for your B, C's, and S's of that, because in that case it's much easier to just recognize the Riescheloff isogenies on that thing to start with. And once you look at its images under the Riescheloff isogenies that your variety actually admits, you can check for those whether they're 2-2 split. So for that, it's not so important. Although there's something else that you can do, and that's sort of a popular pastime for people, and that is to try and find equations of Humbert surfaces, the locus of inside the moduli space of genus 2, Jacobians with larger endomorphism ring, and in this case you'd get Humbert surfaces of square discriminant, where the endomorphism ring really just is a GL2. And since you have a model here, you can generate plenty of points. You just specialize your parameters and compute Ecosse invariants. And, well, if you can generate points on your surface, and you know your surface is an algebraic surface, so it has to satisfy some equation of a limited degree, you can just interpolate. So then from there, it's really just linear algebra to try and find an equation of your surface. But there are other techniques that are essentially boil down to this trick. But work for arbitrary Humbert surfaces, whereas this only works for 4-4 split Jacobians. So there's something else that you can do, though, and that's always interesting when you have a family, and that is to look at what happens for the different bad values, because there's plenty of values here where you specialize your S to a value, for instance, and you might end up getting something that's actually not describing a genus 2 curve. So how does this interact with, well, the boundary of at least this model, and how does that actually interact with the boundaries in your moduli space? So one thing that you can do here, for instance, is move your point S to infinity. And if we go back to our formulas here, if we move S to infinity, well, it's not clear what happens to this parameter. We'll just ignore that for now. But geometrically, at least, it means that you're moving A to infinity. Now, A was the branch, because our elliptic curve E2 was branched over the same three finite points that E1 was branched over, and then it was also branched over the point A. Now, we're moving that point to infinity. That's the point where E1 was already ramified. So this is taking a limit where E2 actually goes to E1, at least geometrically. So that's a valid construction, so that there you'd get E1 times E1. And, well, it's possible that you get 4-4 split Jacobians that look like that. So if you do that in this family, if you do it in this formula, then things degenerate because the degrees don't match up. But you can fix that. You can just make a little reparametrization so that the thing does become regular for s goes to infinity. And if you do that and let go s go to infinity, you get this model. So indeed, this curve C admits an extra involution. If you look carefully at the equation, you can send x to delta divided by 4x. That means that the Jacobian of this curve, geometrically at least, is 2-2 split. But what happened here is we went to the anti-isometric family. And if you take E1 and you want to write down an elliptic curve with the same J invariant, but now with anti-isometric four torsion, that's not going to be E1 itself. It's going to be the twist of E1 by its discriminant. So that gives you the E2 here. So really, we find that our intermediate object that we got here, so the thing that was originally a 2-2 split Jacobian, is really the Wey restriction with respect to the critic extension, where you join the discriminant of E1. There's again a typo here. The Wey restriction of E1. So those are also examples of abelian varieties, Wey restrictions of elliptic curves. In geometric stories, you never see them because, well, they would just be isomorphic to a product of an elliptic curve with itself. But if you're working over non-algebraically closed fields, then the Wey restriction of elliptic curve with respect to a critic extension is actually something different. So what you get here is indeed that you can make 4-4 split Jacobians by taking an elliptic curve and taking its direct product with the twist of that elliptic curve by its discriminant. So it won't work if the discriminant is not a square. The intermediate thing here, your J2, will just be this Wey restriction. And the 4-4 split Jacobian, that is geometrically 2-2 split, will be the Jacobian of this curve C over here. So you do get a nice boundary case in this particular situation.
Are you saying you can glue it to its twist, but you can't glue it to itself?
You can glue it to itself, but the problem is that the Wey pairing will not restrict to a trivial pairing on the diagonal embedding in that case. So if you mod out by that diagonal, which is really the only subgroup that you can get a hold of, you would not get a principally polarized abelian variety. So, yeah. So it's in that's this special thing about. So originally, actually, I didn't know that twisting by the discriminant flips the Wey pairing for 4-torsion. So I originally did this computation and found this. And then I said, hey. And then once you know that you want to prove that, it's easy to prove that critic twisting by the discriminant flips the Wey pairing on the 4-torsion. It's a straightforward proof. And then if you read a little bit further, you find that it was already known as well. So it's one of those things that's actually a nice cross-check. If you did your computations correctly, if you get something unexpected, or that I wasn't expecting at least, that actually matches up with theory, it helps a little bit.
As long as delta is not a square, right?
So a consequence of this is, if you take an elliptic curve that has square discriminant, then the 4-torsion will actually also be anti-isometric to itself.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. So that's
So there you don't see the difference anymore. Okay, yeah, I think I used up about 50 minutes. So.
More questions?
So what's the smallest height over Q of a curve with 4-4 split Jacobian in terms of the equation?
I haven't looked at that at all. Usually isogenies don't, once you start with the data, you can just take an elliptic curve and, So you're really asking, if you take a curve with prescribed four torsion, what is going to be the height of other elliptic curves with anti-isometric four torsion? Because the isogenies are not really going to change any heights. If you want to get a small example, I guess you could just try fill in some small numbers in here. So you want me to sort of give you an estimate of the degrees that happen in here, right? So this d here, that happens to occur in cubes in this denominator here, so you could simplify that a little bit. That's of degree 4 in S, and, well, it's up to degree 2 and 3 in B and C, so it's something weighted homogeneous, where you have to assign the right weights to B, C, and S. I don't immediately see which things. It goes up to degree 11 in S here, so filling in values for S is going to make things go up quite quickly. Do you add degree 9 here? And in your B's and C's here, I see squares, seventh powers. So, yeah. I haven't looked at that particular question.
Also, in this family, do you expect there to be a rational point with about the same frequency as you would for general genus two curves?
I haven't thought about that, so my default answer would be yes in those cases, because I don't immediately see how it would influence it. The frequency of rational points really is, asymptotically zero, so. I don't immediately see how the Jacobian would interfere too much with having rational points on it or not. Okay, well, thank you for your attention. Oh.